Simeon and Anna. And this week, I want to talk about the people that we do spend some time talking about. Those others, we really don't normally hear about them in church that often. But this one is one that we hear about a lot in church and is preached about a lot. And that is the shepherds who came to visit and worship Jesus on the night he was born. So these are the people who were really on the scene first, other than Mary and Joseph and any other people who were helping attend to Mary that evening. These are the people who showed up first after the birth of Christ. So I'm not going to really be able to tell you a whole lot about shepherds that you don't already know or haven't already heard about. So I want to talk to you a little bit about who those people were. So shepherds, well, shepherds even today are people of what kind of a lower estate, right? So when you think of somebody who makes their living working with animals in a field on a daily basis, you don't think CEOs and multimillionaires. Even though there are some people who might own the animals who are millionaires, the people who actually work with the animals day to day usually are pretty common people. And so as I thought about that, I thought about, well, there was a point in my life where I went from listening to rock and roll music to listening to country music. And it was about the time that Garth Brooks was just becoming popular. And he has a song that's called "I Have Friends in Low Places," right? For those of you who are country and western fans, you know that song. It's a very popular song. For those of you who aren't, well, maybe just go through life not knowing about that song. But the reality is, it's about thinking about this fact that he had friends in low places. And so I wanted to talk to you today a little bit about people who we sometimes pass by, who we sometimes look down upon, who we sometimes ignore because of where they're at in society. And I wanted to talk to you about how important they were to God and how important they still are to God. So this week, we found out last week we had to build a ramp for somebody at their home. This week we went and built the ramp. We went and built the ramp on the warmest day of the week, during the week this week. But it still wasn't warm, but we were out there. And so you have to understand, when I say we, I mean they. Because I really don't do a whole lot when I go to build a ramp. You know, I'm the official board getter. You know, like this board from here to there. I can do that. But it's amazing the things that occur beforehand and when you're there and how smoothly it goes, because multiple ramps have been made in the past. So I'm going to embarrass a few people today. Tuck, you're just going to have to deal with it. I'm not going to look at anybody when I do this, so as not to embarrass them directly. But there were several people that were there at the ramp building that it would, if I showed up, me, and the wood was sitting there, today the wood would still be sitting there. Because there would be no ramp. Or there would be pieces of ramp, but not a ramp that was complete. So the main person who designs the ramp is Jamie, and Jamie has a program that he uses, and it tells him exactly what wood to buy and what to do and how to do it. When he draws it out, he gives it the specs, he enters it into the computer. He works at it very hard, And then he creates the framework for the ramp. It's already built. It's put together. It shows up. It's already there. And it's like a jigsaw puzzle. As long as you know, slot A goes into peg B, you can make the ramp. And so when I got there, Jamie was already there, and Alex McAdams was already there, and there were some people from the family already there. And I stood back, and I just took a look. Because sometimes it helps to take a look to see how the ramp goes together. And so one of the people who was there with the family must have thought I was somebody important, because they said to me, "Does it look right?" If they only knew who they were talking to. But I said, "Oh yeah, it looks really good. They do a great job." Like I had some magical eyeball that could see whether the ramp was correct or not. And so Jamie is directing people with what to do and where to go, because he's got the master plan in his brain. It exists in his brain. He can see it. And it was fun to watch Alex McAdams, because Alex, he's an engineer. So as soon as he understood what was happening inside of Jamie's brain, he had the picture in his head too. And so it was amazing to watch as it began to come together. Posts begin to go up, boxes begin to go on, and then there's a point at which you begin to lay down the decking. And the decking was already cut, and my job was to just make sure that people had the supplies that they needed so that they could keep going and doing the job that they were doing. It's a simple job. It's a fun job, but I get to watch people. And so I got to watch the people from the family who we built the ramp for. Now, these are people that, let's face it, I don't normally hang out with. We're in a poorer area of Lima, and it was funny, because at first, I thought there was an employee of the prison there, because this man was talking about jail, and he was talking about all the different jobs that he did in jail. And then I realized, no, he was a resident of the jail. He had those different jobs as a resident of the jail. He was working while he was incarcerated. It took me a minute to catch on. And it's funny, because as I'm working, they don't know who I am. Nobody calls me Pastor Paul. No one says Reverend anything. So I'm working along, but there becomes a point at which everybody finds out who I am. And it's usually at that point, you can see it whisper around to all the people who are not church members. For those of you who couldn't hear that, I said, "Stop cussing in front of him." That's usually what they say to one another. Because, well, let's face it, that Garth Brooks song applies here. I made some friends in low places this week. They were great people. They wanted their mom, aunt, grandmother, cousin to get home for Christmas. Just like I would want my mom to get home for Christmas, he wanted his mom to get home for Christmas. We're still human beings. We have that same love for our mother. But it is always funny when they figure out who I am and the whispers begin. And that is the end of any conversation that occurs with the people that were building the ramp with me. Now they'll continue to talk to Alex and to Jamie and to Dan and to Brady. They'll talk to everybody. But to me, nothing. Crickets. It is so funny. So, this is a great example for us of what it means for this Christmas story of these shepherds. These were people that nobody wanted to associate with. I talked about it a little bit with the kids. These were people who lived with the animals. And they still have shepherds in this area of the world right now. I have a cold right now, so I'm going to be taking drinks because I don't want to shorten this sermon because I know you want the full sermon. So, these shepherds that were in this field were common, everyday guys. Maybe some gals, too. And beyond that, they were the night shift. No. And for any of you who've ever worked afternoons or nights, you know some of the quirky people work night shift, right? People who are a little bit different than the rest of us. I enjoyed working night shifts, I'll admit it. Afternoons are a good shift to have when you don't have kids. I like working with quirky, strange people. So here are these night shift shepherds, and the angels appear to them, and they go in to see Mary and Joseph. Now, they did not stop off at home, put on their dress clothes, take a bath, put on their dress clothes, and shave before they went. They went straight from the field right to see the baby Jesus. So, these are people who spend their time with sheep. They spend all of their time with sheep. They are elbows deep in sheep, as it were. Whatever happens with the sheep, they have to deal with. If a ewe is lambing, they have to help. If a sheep is sick, they have to take care of it. If something's attacking the sheep, they have to fight it off. If there's anything going on, they are elbows deep in sheep. So let's say, in the nicest way possible, they had an odor of sheep with them wherever they went. And so here they are, coming in to the manger, in to the barn, into the cave, wherever it was that Mary and Joseph were at. Here they come into that area to see the king. Because they've been told by angels that a child's been born who is to be king. God chose lowest and the least that he could find to announce first that the king had been born. I want you to think about that for a minute. The lowest and the least. First, most important. Jesus uses the term the last shall be first and the first shall be last. But sometimes I think we gloss that over. In history, before the birth of Christ, the most important thing for human beings was honor. And we even see it in some of the teachings of Jesus. They talk about the honor seat. Who has the highest honor? We see the disciples saying, who will be first? We see it in the disciples' mothers, even, who come to try and get their sons the highest seat of honor in the hierarchy with Jesus. And Jesus continually tells us it's not about being first. It's about being humble. It's about having humility. Now, this is dangerously thin ice for me. Because anybody who will stand up in a pulpit and tell you about humility probably does not have it down. And probably does a poor job of it. And I want to say to you, this is something that I am working on. It was really hard for me to be humble today when I walked in and I heard my daughter playing the flute practicing for the 24th. I want to just scream to you, But I can't, because I'm supposed to be humble. That was my way of getting around being humble. Did you see it? Good, I'm glad you paid attention. So, this idea of humility that we so value as a culture begins with the birth of Christ. In philosophy, it goes from being honored to being humble about this time in the world. It is the teachings of Jesus Christ that give us this idea that humility is the most important thing. And I looked for stories about humility. And I came across one. It's out of the book Humilitas. Oh, I can't remember. It's Richardson or Dickerson, or I can't remember the name of the author, but the name of the book is Humilitas. And the story goes something like this. Three or four young white men are getting on a bus in the city of Detroit in the 1930s. And they get on the bus, and the bus is completely empty except for the bus driver and one lone man sitting in the back of the bus, an African-American man. And so these four young white men go to the back of the bus to give the African-American man a hard time. And they get in his face, and they taunt him, and they call him names. And he sits, and he stares straight ahead. He occasionally looks at them, but he never says a word to them. And they continue to taunt him, and they continue to give him a hard time. He's seated there on the bus, and eventually the bus gets to his stop, and he stands to get off the bus. And when he stands to get off the bus, the four boys are taken aback because he is such a large man. They have severely underestimated the size of this man. He is a specimen, as it were. He stands up and he walks off the bus, and the whole time he has not said a single word to them. He's wearing an overcoat, and he reaches into his overcoat pocket. He pulls out a card and he hands it to one of the boys as he's leaving the bus. He leaves the bus and goes on his way, and the bus doors close, and the bus driver pulls away, and the four boys sit down. And one of them looks at the card. And all it said on the card was, "Jodelous Boxer." The greatest heavyweight boxer of all time. Heavyweight champion from 1937 to 1949. It was said he could knock out a horse with a single punch. A horse. Not just a human being, a horse. He had absolutely picked the wrong person. And he could have pummeled each and every one of them.
But he didn't. Because he was a humble man. Joe Louis,
great boxer, great champion, great humanitarian, died poor.
And it wasn't because he
didn't have money, it was because he gave all his money away. In fact, he had to live off the kindness of strangers for the last part of his life.
Because he was poor. Humility, humbleness, something maybe we all could learn from. God chose not to say to the whole world, to the kings of the world, to the leaders of the world, to the most important people of the world first, "My son is born, worship him." God did not choose that. God chose to find the humblest people he could find, the lowest people he could find. He found some shepherds in a field, men and women who smelled terrible, men and women who were avoided by society. We too, are surrounded by these very people. I had a chance to meet a few this week, get to know them a little bit better, and to realize that they want for their family what I want for my family. You have an opportunity to help them. You have, through building that ramp, the money that you have already given. But we have a hat and mitten tree. We have Christmas gifts that we send through Operation Christmas Child to children. We have monthly coins for communion that help the different charities around our community. We have a Christmas and Easter offering that don't pay for any of the bills of this church but are given away to those who are less fortunate. We have opportunities to serve. We have a new one coming through Family Promise. We have others through the Samaritan House and through Our Daily Bread and through Meals Till Monday. There are many places here in our community where we can make a difference. We made a difference in a family who is now our neighbor through Habitat for Humanity. You make a difference. And I want to encourage you to continue to have those friends in low places. Because in doing that, you are following the teachings of the King. You are following the teachings of God as you make a difference to the least and to the lost. And I want to thank you because you continue to remain humble. And I know I'm going to be in trouble from both Jamie and Alex later for mentioning them, but I don't care because you need to know that without those two, that ramp wouldn't be there. Because if I showed up, it'd still just be a pile of wood. I know that for a fact. I mean, I'd try, but I don't think it would be legal. And it certainly would be too steep. I know that for sure. So take a little time when you get a chance and make a few friends in low places and affect their lives. Not just during the Christmas season, but all next year as well. Will you pray with me? God of grace and mercy, we give thanks for this day and for your example to us of choosing the least and lost and the humblest. Help us this day to make that possible for the least and the lost here in our community and throughout the world, through our actions, our donations. In Jesus' name, amen. Before we start the next hymn, we're going to stand to sing. The kids, if everything worked out right, have made you all a treat. So when we are done singing the hymn, I'm not going to give the blessing right away. They are going to come and give you this treat. So stay standing. When you get yours, sit down, and when everybody's seated, I'll know that you have all received your treat. Can you do that for me? All right, let's sit.